In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
Good morning, dear friends. Welcome to the Hour of Power and thanks for your support to us. Our program is bilingual broadcast, other than original English. If your TV is equipped with NACAM facility, you can watch Hour of Power in Cantonese. On October the 24th, we had a happy time together with Pastor Bobby Schiller and Mrs. Hannah Schiller. This was really a good gathering, and Pastor Bobby Schiller encouraged us with his message and sharing. We will uphold our power mission for God in the world. Please pray for us and support us so that our Power Hong Kong ministry can continue to spread the blessings of God in Hong Kong, Macau, and other areas. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took the lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with the lamps. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. Today, Pastor Bobby Schiller advises us, be ready for God. Life is not a single line. There are lots of ups and downs. Very often, we are too busy, too hurried, and too tired to listening to God's voice. Pastor Bobby Schiller teaches us the importance of being ready for God. He uses the parable of the 10 virgins to teach us the importance of having our lamps lit and being oil-filled person who are ready to get into the moves of God. The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took the lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with the lamps. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. If we are going to be the people of the Spirit, Pastor Bobby Schiller teaches us, be aware of these things. Number one, our ego. When we care about too much of reputation management, we will miss out on the big things of God. Number two, platonism. Everything must be practical. This sometimes can ruin our spiritual life. When we are too busy and become restless, more work, more internet, more emails, then we won't have the spiritual eyes and ears to see and hear what God is doing. So let's be the wise virgins, be full of oil, and get prepared for the kingdom of God, and be ready to move for God.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome, church family. You are loved. Thank you for being with us here today. You know, in my quiet times this week, I have been feeling so much joy knowing that God is on my side. Whatever it is you're going through right now, you can have joy this morning because the God of the universe is on your side. Thank you, Jesus. Turn around and shake the hand of the person next to you and say, God loves you, and so do I.
We're just so glad that you're here, and we want you to leave this place with a full tank, full of joy and fresh vision. And so let's begin today in prayer. Father, thank you that you've invited us to this wedding feast, to this gathering. We thank you, Lord, that your presence, your power, and your life are here. Lord, we love you so much, and we couldn't even live without you, and we're so thankful that you love us in return, and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May be seated. In preparation for Bobby's message, the words of our Lord found in Matthew 25:1. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom! Come out to meet him!" Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." Church family, we are preparing ourselves for the next great thing God is doing in our lives. Amen.
So would you join me this morning as we lift our hearts before the Lord? Father, we are so thankful for what you are doing here in this place. Lord, being part of two churches who are coming together to proclaim the goodness of your name in this city and around the world is such an exciting thing. Lord, we pray for your continued leading of this church into the future as we seek after what it is you have for us. Lord, we pray that we be an impact in this city. We pray that we be an impact in this county. We pray that we be an impact for your name in this region. And Lord, we pray that we be an impact all over the world. Lord, we love you. Lord, and we pray for Pastor Bobby as he brings your word, the word that you have placed on his heart. Lord, we pray for open minds and open hearts of our own as we listen. Lord, and finally, we pray the way that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us today, and we want to encourage you, come down to Irvine. If you're anywhere near Disneyland or something like that, you come on down to Irvine with us here at Shepherd's Grove and Irvine Presbyterian Church. We'd love to see you. Hannah and I would love to give you a big hug, and we'd love to teach your kids the things of God, so bring them. Friends, let's say this together. Hold your hands like this, and let's say this together. I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks. Keep it seated. Well, today I'm going to talk about the importance of being ready. Being ready when these great moments and opportunities come our way. Being ready in particular for the kingdom of God. Amen. When I say the kingdom of God, I don't mean just heaven and hell and judgment and the return of Christ. I also mean the things of God that are happening today in our daily life. And I want to talk about the importance of having oil in our lamps, of being full of the Holy Spirit, so we can have spiritual ears and eyes to see when God is doing great things in our communities or in our lives, so that we can get aboard those things. And, it's important that we recognize that opportunity is a rare thing, but when it comes and when we take advantage of it, it can have incredible results. You think about a decision you made maybe once or twice in your life that maybe took some risk or courage, and you were just ready and just primed for it, and you leaped on that opportunity, and it made all the difference. Maybe it's even having an impact on your life today. Maybe you think of something in your life in which you didn't jump on it. You thought you should have, and you didn't. But, you know, something where you missed out on a relationship, a date, a trip, and you recognize, man, if I had only done that, if I'd been ready and leapt for that opportunity, you ask yourself, how might my life be different? So today I want to talk about the importance of recognizing that life is not a very, you know, seamless, singular line, but it's these big spiking moments. Too often as people, we're too busy, too hurried, too out of energy, and too out of sync with God's voice to leap on these things. And that's a bad thing. And we want to remove the things that get in the way of us living in the life of the Spirit. So think about an opportunity that made a difference in your life. I know one for me. One huge opportunity that made a difference in my life was when I started dating this beautiful young woman over here, my wife Hannah. And I remember I met Hannah when I was 15. And I feel bad saying this, but I was introduced to her by a girl I was dating at the time. We weren't super serious, but this girl introduced me to Hannah, and Hannah turned around, and I was stunned. If there was ever a love at first sight moment for me, that was it. And I remember for really years, I think it was 4, maybe even 5 years, I had this big crush on Hannah. She was dating another guy at the time, and so I wasn't really, I hadn't learned yet that, you know, you should just go for it anyway. And so she was dating. I dated other people, and I, you know, at the time too, I had acne, and I was nervous when I talked to her, and I had these big fluffy shoes, so she hadn't seen the Lord's will yet for her life. I mean, she wasn't that interested. So when college came around, and maybe I blossomed a little bit, she had broken up with her boyfriend, this guy. Anyway, and there was a window of opportunity for me, but it was a day before I was supposed to leave on a 6-month trip for Germany. So I left and didn't get to see her. When I came back, she was with that guy again. It was just, it was a mess. Finally, as summer came around and she was single again, we happened to go on a missionary trip together. Her brother was a dear friend of mine, and so we were on this missionary trip in Panama. And we got to know each other a little bit better, although I wouldn't say we were even great friends at the time. We were just sort of getting to know one another. And when we were there, I was talking to her and one of our mutual friends, Natasha, and I said, you guys should come out to California and visit me sometime. We'll go fishing and do some of the, you know, go to the beach, whatever. And so later that summer, her brother and one of our friends, Nate, and she came out, the three of them, to visit me in California. And I just went for it. I was flirting with her, and I was trying to get the other two guys busy so I could talk to her and get to know her. And there was this moment, her brother, Chris, who was a friend of mine, he was getting married only a few days later. And she said, gosh, I wish you were coming to Chris's wedding. You know, there's all this chemistry all of a sudden. And I said, well, what if I do come? I said, I'll tell you what. I'll come out to that wedding if you give me either the first or the last dance at the wedding. And she said, if you come out to the wedding, I'll give you both. And so she's like, I'm going for it. Look, I was 19. I had no money, right? I had no money. I had no way of knowing how I was going to get out to Tulsa, but I knew that this was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I had to get to that wedding, and I had to dance with this girl. And if I had to walk to Tulsa, I was going to start the day she left. You know, I was going to get there, hitchhike, whatever I could to get there. And I did. And so we went, and we danced the night away, and we really hit it off. And that was kind of when it was at the beginning of our, like, kind of dating relationship. And we talked about it later. Had I not gone out to that wedding, I'm not sure we would have dated and then gotten married, because there were lots of other good-looking, you know, great guys out there who were very interested in Hannah. And if I'm back in California, my opportunity is shot. By the way, I took a camera with me, and this was the picture from that night. Isn't that adorable? She is so beautiful, isn't she? She is just still is more beautiful than ever. And I'm so glad for that. Okay, you can take a picture down. The reason I begin with that is that if you think about it, much of your success in life is probably the result of a few key decisions. Maybe they're a big risk like that. You had to go for something. You didn't know how you were going to do it, but you knew this was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I think when we're young, we feel like we have more of those opportunities. But I think that's because when we're young, we're not as busy, bogged down, anxious, and worried. That's maybe not true for all of us. But I think that something happens to us. Opportunity doesn't go away, but something happens to our ears and our eyes where we lose the ability to see, whoa, this is something I need to get aboard this, whatever this is. You know, it's really true. There's this economist named Vilfredo Pareto called the Pareto Principle. It's this idea that sometimes we call it the 80-20 rule. That 20% of the stuff in life gives us 80% of the results. And 80% of the stuff gives us 20% of the results. And what he noticed is that most of the stuff that we do in life doesn't really produce that much. That most of the stuff that makes us wealthy, successful, good in our relationships, good at whatever craft that we're working on, the stuff that makes us excellent comes down to a much smaller sample group than we think. It comes down to some of those important decisions and some of that critical work that makes all the difference. We need to recognize this, that most of the stuff that we're doing is a waste of time. That the most important things we do, whether it be professionally, in our relationships, or most importantly, in the kingdom of God. And so, you know, it doesn't matter. If you make millions of dollars, and if you conquer the world, and if you hold the world in your hands, but you lose your soul, you've lost everything. And what life is worth is our friendships, our marriages, our kids, our family, and most importantly, our relationship with God. And it's also true that the Pareto Principle, that the 80-20 rule, the opportunity that's available in our happiness and in our life comes down to these key moments in life. And we need to become the kind of people who are ready to seize those moments when they come. And not only ready to seize them, but able to see them. And this is what Jesus is going to teach us in Matthew 25, the importance of having our lamps lit, of being oil-filled people who are ready to get on into the moves of God, and they are many and they are great. When God is on the move, to be ready to jump on that wave. It's like surfing, actually. Here we are in Southern California, that the moves of God are not like everything else. It's not one fluid thing, but they come in waves. If you're a surfer, you sit out on the water and you wait for a long time sometimes for a set of 3, 4, 5 big waves, and you don't want to miss out on them, and you can only usually grab one of them. And so in that same way, God, the Holy Spirit of God and the kingdom of God moves in history through waves. And we can be ready for those waves or we can miss out on them. So we need to become people of the Spirit who are listening and who are always in the presence of the kingdom of God, that have oil, that are ready. Amen? Amen? That's what Jesus teaches. Matthew chapter 25. Hannah already read it. I'm going to read it again just so we can think through this. Now, when Jesus is preaching, he's getting ready to go to the cross, and he is for sure here talking about eschatology, which is a big word that means the end of all things, the end of my life or the judgment of God. But he's also talking about the kingdom of God, which is not just the end of life, but is happening now. So he says, at the time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins. We'll just say that means unmarried women in particular. So, 10 teenage girls who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 of them were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. You get that? So some brought the lamps with oil in it, so they could be lit, but others brought the lamp with oil in it, and they brought like an extra bit of oil. Make sense? Like a side jar of oil to refill. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. Notice how both the wise and the foolish are sleeping. It's okay to sleep, huh? It's okay to wait. It's okay to take a nap. Jesus took naps. Next time your spouse bugs you for taking a nap, just say, I'm being Christ-like. Just following the Lord. At midnight, the cry rang out, here's the bridegroom, come out to meet him. Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out. No, they replied, there may not be enough for both of us and for you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves. But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. Lord, Lord, they said, open the door for us. But he replied, truly, I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. Now, in this passage, Jesus is talking about the end of things, but he's also talking about the present. He's talking about the fact that many of the Pharisees who are there don't recognize that in himself, in the very body and life of Jesus, the kingdom of God has come. Now, before I get too much into that, let me explain Jewish weddings. In those days, those ancient days, weddings were weird, and it's like, why is a wedding happening in the middle of the night? And the reason is because it's a Middle Eastern culture. This is just a thing they do. They would have the bride and the groom would get together. We're not really quite sure what's happening here, but the bride and the groom either had a wedding or their parents were meeting to discuss essentially the contractual agreement between two families becoming one, things like a dowry, transfer of property. And that could take a while, and then what happens is these bridegrooms and everybody else in the village, they get into this processional. Now, this is a big deal because in those days, people were pretty bored. They're farmers, there's no TV, they're not wealthy, and so when a wedding happens, it's this huge, amazing, big, sometimes it'll go on for days, celebration, and especially the young girls, this is like the greatest thing that's going to happen all year. This is so important because when Jesus is talking about the wedding, he's talking about joy, laughter, singing, dancing, jokes. being alive, being human. And this is the invitation that the kingdom of God, the arrival of the kingdom of God, is this big celebration. And he's telling them, don't miss out on it. And that's exactly what happens, is these women, these girls, they don't bring extra oil. And so notice how the oil, the lamps, they burn out. So it's not that they were never burning, they just burned out. And they just didn't have enough and didn't have any left. And so they became people with lamps without oil. In those days too, you know, they would then go to the groom's house, and there they would gather and they would celebrate. But it was illegal to be out on the street at night without a lamp, because that's when thieves would do their thieving. And so if somebody arrives at a house, again, it's only candle lit, and they knock on the door and you can't see who's out there, you're not going to open the door. You don't know who's out there. You're not going to allow somebody to come in and rob your wedding and to damage this most important day of this young family's life. And that's what Jesus says it's like, that if you're not ready, if you're not prepared, whether it comes to the end of your life or whether it comes to these great opportunities in life, your hopes will be dashed. You'll be like these young girls who, because they ran out of oil, they weren't prepared to be a part of what God was doing. He is telling us, look for the kingdom of God. Prepare for the kingdom of God and be full of oil. Full of oil. In the Bible, the oil is always a symbol of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God within us. And that's why I believe when Jesus is telling this parable, he's in large part talking to the Pharisees, probably men who started out with oil, full of joy, full of the Holy Spirit, but as they got older, ran out of flame, ran out of fire, and just simply became men of rules, statutes, and rites. In Jesus' words, they became whitewashed tombs. They were gorgeous on the outside, but dead on the inside. They were lamps without oil. They had everything on the outside they needed to burn, but no fuel, nothing on the inside to bring light or warmth or fire. They were oilless lamps. And this is the greatest temptation for every religious person. It's to run out of oil. You got the lamp, you got everything that you need for burning, but no oil. This is why Jesus says to the Pharisees, you study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. But these are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me and have life. The kingdom of God, it comes in waves, and when it comes, it is a celebration. It's joyful. I think it's really interesting how often Jesus uses weddings as a parable. He does it a lot, and he uses wine a lot. Like, actually, remember Jesus' first miracle? He turns water into wine at a wedding. Because for people who drank too much, they ran out of wine. And then he made the good stuff. It's this idea of the celebration, the joy, the laughter, and the goodness of the kingdom of God. It really is joyful. And that when the scriptures teach us that the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy, the first two things it mentions, love and joy, they are describing the same fruit. In the same way an apple is red on the outside and white on the inside, so the Spirit of God, love on the outside and joy on the inside. And that's why Jesus uses a wedding and not a funeral as a description for the kingdom of God. It's a celebration. It's awesome. And something that we don't want to miss out on. We need to become people full of the Holy Spirit of God. Full of oil. Full of oil. And friends, let me tell you, there is no shortage of oil, and that's the good news. No shortage. The Holy Spirit is available to every believer. When you were baptized, when you confess Jesus as the Lord of your life, it's like he gave you a pilot light. And that little light, it doesn't have much light at all or warmth or anything, but then he also gave you gas, and that gas is the Spirit of God. And he's also given you, what is it called, a gas valve or something like that. So it's like this. You have this pilot light, and you've got gas available, and you've got that little gas knob. Turn it on, baby. Turn it on. Have some joy. Life. Spirit, so that you're ready. You're ready for the things of God. Ready. Full of courage and joy and eyes to see and ears to hear. Amen. So we got to be people who are ready for the kingdom of God. I'm telling you to be a person full of the Holy Spirit, a person who looks for and is ready for the things of God, because the things of God come in waves, and when they come, you must be ready for it. I think that this is one of those things right here. This church is a move of God. God is doing something in this church right now. This wasn't my idea. It just came out of nowhere. And I think we're yet to see more happen even here, which is good news. If we're to be people of the Spirit, before we talk about what we need to do, and I don't even know if we need to do that, we need to talk about what's in the way. And I'm going to look to Ronald Rollheiser for this. Rollheiser says that there's three things. I'm going to give you three things in 3 minutes before I finish. Are you ready? The first thing that gets in the way of the life of the Spirit is egotism. Now, he says narcissism, and I think it's too extreme of a word. I think egotism is a little bit better because it describes what all of us struggle with. It's all about me. And it takes many forms, doesn't it? It's like egotism can look like reputation management. If I act that way, or if I do that thing, or if I tell people I heard from God, or if I take this big risk, what are people going to think of me? What's going to happen to my reputation? And so it creates fear in our hearts, and we miss out on the big things of God, the opportunities, the moves of the Spirit, or the big opportunities in life. The second one, I want to be careful about this, but the second thing that gets in the way is pragmatism. Now, I'm a pragmatic person. I really am. And I think it's good to be pragmatic. But when pragmatism becomes your highest value, it destroys your soul. It gets in the way of the best things in life. And what I mean here when I say pragmatism is that everything must be practical. And many of us are that way, especially in the modern world. But what's practical about surfing? What's practical about kissing, or singing, or Disneyland? What's practical about those things? And I guess that's my point, is that the pragmatism, the lens of pragmatism, can ruin our spiritual life. Be pragmatic, but not in everything. And finally, the number three thing, pragmatism leads to this, and that's unbridled restlessness. We just never stop. We're always going, going. Going, going, doing, doing, doing. More work, more driving, more traffic, more errands, more this, more that, more TV, more internet, more emails, sleep, wake up, eat, go, 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 go. You don't have to live that way. The greatest successes in your life are going to be the result of grabbing on to these moments. And if you're busy, too busy doing all this stuff, busy all the time and restless, you won't have the eyes or the ears to jump on board what God has in store for you. In order to live by the Spirit, you have to breathe. The word for the Holy Spirit in the Bible, in Hebrew, it's the Ruach Elohim. It's the Ruach, it means breath. Spirit, breath and spirit. Same thing in Greek. Pneuma is this idea of breath and spirit. It's the same thing. So many of us, we exhale all the time, right? We're exhaling, doing, doing, but we never inhale. Right? So living the life of the Spirit is about inhaling and exhaling spiritually, that we have these moments where we stop and we think and we don't do anything and we reflect. And we listen for what the Spirit is doing. We look for where the Spirit is going. And we jump and get on board with that. Let's be ready, friends. Full of joy, full of oil, full of the Spirit. Ready to move. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That's what we need. We're nothing without it. We're everything with it. Lord, we thank you and we love you. We ask in Jesus' name. Lord, even just now, we take a moment and open up our soul to heaven. And we ask, Lord, in Jesus' name, that you would pour out so much of your life and your Spirit, that you'd create a revival and fire and life and listening and joy, especially within this community, with everyone under the sound of my voice. Lord, we love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now for the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.
Thanks for watching Our Power and your support to us. On October the 24th, we had a happy time together with Pastor Bobby Schiller and Mrs. Hannah Schiller. This was really a good gathering. And Pastor Bobby Schiller encouraged us with his message and sharing. We will uphold our power mission for God in the world. Please pray for us and support us so that our Power Hong Kong ministry can continue to spread the blessings of God in Hong Kong, Macau, and other areas. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 25, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. The foolish ones took the lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with the lamps. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. Today, Pastor Bobby Schiller advises us, be ready for God. Life is not a single line. There are lots of ups and downs. Very often, we are too busy, too hurried, and too tired to listening to God's voice. Pastor Bobby Schiller teaches us the importance of being ready for God. He uses the parable of the 10 virgins to teach us the importance of having our lamps lit and being oil-filled person who are ready to get into the moves of God.
The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The foolish ones took the lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with the lamps. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour.
If we are going to be the people of the Spirit, Pastor Bobby Schiller teaches us, be aware of these things. Number one, our ego. When we care about too much of reputation management, we will miss out on the big things of God. Number two, platonism. Everything must be practical. This sometimes can ruin our spiritual life. When we are too busy and become restless, more work, more internet, more emails, then we won't have the spiritual eyes and ears to see and hear what God is doing. So let's be the wise virgins, be full of oil, and get prepared for the kingdom of God, and be ready to move for God. Our Power This Motivational TV program is broadcast weekly on TVB Pearl Channel. Every Saturday at 10 a.m. in the morning and every Sunday morning at 8 a.m. And you can also watch online simultaneously on MyTV Super and www.hourofpower.org.hk. Thanks for joining. God loves you and see you next week on TVB Pearl.